a few weeks ago, we worked on it, and I did some a little bit of a, I guess, a Bible study on it, a little lesson about Mephibosheth in the Old Testament, one of Saul's nephews, I think it was, or grandson. Was it grandson? Grandson. And David took over as king, and David called out for Saul's grandson to come in. He says, "Is there anybody out there left of Saul's family that we can pretty much love on?" And this boy was dropped as a five-year-old. I think he was 5 years old when he got dropped in the middle of a war. They were fleeing an area out there, and his caretaker dropped him and crippled him. And he said, "Is there anyone out there in Saul's family that we can bring in?" And at the time, in Israel, they had just made a law before that no, I think it was nobody that was deaf or blind or lame could enter into the city or enter into the inner corridor. And David broke those rules to go outside and love on somebody that was actually Saul. Saul and David weren't like best of pals there for a while. And to love on somebody that probably, in our minds, probably wouldn't be worth it. And he went against everything to bring him into his table, and said, and he ate with him. And he ate with him. And man, if that isn't salvation, Jesus coming out of his way for me, where I was, and saving me and allowing me to eat at his table. But here's that song.
Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. That sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. So come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table. The thief and to the doubter, to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who fail, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong. table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table.
Luke chapter 11, Luke chapter 11. I'm going to tell you the story of how this message came about. Just set it around 5, minus 5 there, and then you're good. You can just leave it alone. There it is. Luke chapter 11. I'll tell you later how this message came about. It was different, nice little story, but I'll save it. Kind of helps make a point at the end. This is a familiar passage. I already mentioned this, but man, I'm looking forward to Easter Sunday. Do you realize it has been a year? We tore down this building a year ago. And we have been without normal services, whatever that is, for a year. A year. What? That's just strange. And be honest with you, I used to think, you know, you've heard me talk about this. We run, we're running about 80 people. You say, well, we never had 80 people. Occasionally we'd have 80 people. Okay, they would, but it was like we came in shifts. There was one Sunday where we had 78, and there were no visitors. Because somebody's like, "Wow, look at all the, you know, the how filled up this was," and there were still people missing. But it was like everybody came on that day. So we were running about 80 people that would come semi regularly. We would just come in shifts. That was good, and that was bad. Because bad, when you have a Sunday like that and you have somebody come in, there's no place to sit. And people that come in and there's no place to sit, and all of a sudden it feels, well, there's no place for me. So you hit, it's like you hit plateaus as a church, or you hit a wall. You get to a certain, being this filled up to a certain capacity, and then all of a sudden you don't grow anymore, and then you lose people, and then it kind of, you know, you just kind of stagnate it that way. And which is, I'm not here to build a big church. We're here to build a kingdom, to reach people. Okay, but it's like, wow. So I had always thought about the possibility of us going to two services, because the only thing we really could do, we don't really have any room to expand building-wise. We are basically filling up our whole property with building now. So it was like, well, what do we do? And I said, well, one of the things we could do was split the services. I thought, well, that's a good idea. Until we split the services. I don't like splitting the services. All right, so, you know, be praying about that. What we're going to do after this. The talk has been to maybe someday take out this wall back here and maybe put the platform over there. We'll obviously have to take that bathroom out, put the platform back there, maybe even put a baptistry in back there, make the main entrance over here, and have the, and that way would, you'd open up all this area for more seating. We could have chairs in here. So that would increase our capacity by about 40 almost. So that would, you know, that's a possibility that we talked about doing that. So maybe, you know, maybe. But just pray. But I really, what I'm really concerned about is this. Okay, I said looking forward to going back to normal, but I'm not. What I mean by that, now I'm looking forward to going back to one service. I'm looking forward to doing things. I don't want to go back to the way we were. I'm not talking about the way we did things. I just don't want to go through the motions of doing church, of being, doing Sunday morning, blah, 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 and here it is, and this is what we do. And I don't think for a second that God gave us this building just so we could have dinners two or three times a year. Okay? There's a purpose for this. Are we ready for what's next? You know. Luke chapter 11. I'm excited about this, but at the same time, I'm a little not so excited because I already preached it once. And what I mean by that is it didn't come out anything like it was in my head. Okay, so, and I told folks this morning, told Peggy, I said, usually I preach it once, I'll preach a message once. Again, I got to get used to preaching only one time. We'll come Easter, I'm like, okay, you don't get to practice this, dude. So, but usually, you know, I'll preach it and be like, okay, I need to tweak this. After I got done this morning, it was like, boy, there's no fixing this. So I'm going to be praying that the Lord will take it and use it in spite of my ramblings. Luke chapter 11, verse 1, here it is. And it came to pass that as he was praying, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he ceased, one of his disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. I want you to try to think about that for a second. What? Imagine hearing Jesus pray or watching him pray. You know, I don't know how far away they were, if they could hear what he was saying. I wouldn't be surprised if he was praying out loud. Matter of fact, there was one time when he prayed out loud and he said, Lord, you know, he said, I thank you that you hear me when I pray. And he says, I know you hear me. He said, I only said that so these guys would hear me say it. You know, I think it was at Lazarus's tomb. So can you imagine? I would love to have heard Jesus pray. I know it wasn't like lofty, oh, Heavenly Father, you know, and just how we hear a lot of ministers, you know, dear God, I pray, Lord God, that you'll, you know, no, he was talking to his dad, and he was impassioned about what he was praying, and the disciples are watching, and he got done, and one of them going, Lord, teach us to pray like that. Teach us to pray. Now, they already knew. You just talked to God. They'd heard Jesus pray, but it's like, no, we don't pray like that. Lord, teach us to pray. So, verse 2, it says, he said unto them, when you pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so on earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Okay, now he repeated this because this was similar to what he had said in the Sermon on the Mount. This wasn't the Sermon on the Mount. This was a conversation he was having with his disciples. So he gave them this model prayer again, but then he goes on and he gives them a little parable. Verse 5. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. It's midnight, dude. I ain't coming down there and giving you. What's wrong with you? My kids are sleeping. Shh. Be quiet. Go away. Come back in the morning. Slam. Hey, didn't you hear me? It's like, dude, I thought we were friends. Yeah, we are friends. We were friends. Stop. You're kind of taking advantage of our friendship, aren't you? I know, I'm sorry, but some people came and they need something and I got it. I know I have nothing. It says, I say unto you, verse 8, though he will not rise and give him because he's his friend, yet because of his importunity, that's a nice way of saying, because he won't leave him alone, he will rise and give him as many as he needeth, just to shut him up. I say unto you, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Okay, so you know the story. You know the picture. The whole idea of importunity and all this stuff. I'm looking at this totally different in a sense, okay? I want to focus on one thought here, one phrase, okay? This might seem a little abstract. I apologize. All right, I'm hoping that somebody here, it'll make sense to. That's not the right word. Strike a chord, touch a nerve. Here it is. Here's the title. Look at verse 6. A friend of mine in his journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. There was a need, and he said, I got nothing. That's my title. I got nothing. Let me pray. Father God, I pray that you'll use my foolishness, my ramblings, and make sense of it in somebody's heart, and mind, and life this morning. God, I know I feel that way too many times. I look around, I see the need. It's overwhelming sometimes. And sometimes you just feel like you got nothing left. And but that's not the case. So, God, again, I just pray, God, that you'll help us right now, that you'll use this time to your honor and glory. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I got nothing. 3 points. 3 points in a story, and I'm all done. All right, number one, I got nothing to give. Oh, you ever feel that way? Like you got nothing to give, Becky? Becky, I love Becky. Well, just a little. Not this much. Becky's always talking about praying for opportunities and stuff, and she's got such a heart for people and a passion to help folks and to be a blessing and to minister to folks. And we got people in our church that way, you know, and I know that's in all of our hearts. That's from God, okay? But you ever feel like you got nothing to give when you look around and you see the stuff folks are going through? You know, and you... We'll talk about this in a second, but holy cow, man. We're surrounded by people that are hurting. Now, I don't know about you. I really am not interested in a church, in pastoring a church, where we're just kind of comfortable, you know, with us and the world can go to hell. You know, we're just going to do us and they can do them and whatever, you know. And if they decide that they don't like what they're doing and they want to join us and become like us, then that's okay. But in the meantime, we're just going to do us and they can do them. Now, I know you guys don't feel that way. But do you ever feel like when you look around and you just feel like you just don't have it? Like you just don't have anything to give? I got nothing. I got nothing to give. What do you do about it? Let me read my notes here so make sure I'm not missing anything. I said, write this. Do you ever feel like that when you look around and you see the great need? And sometimes you hear the stories of how God... I wrote this down too. I said, sometimes you hear the stories of how God, the people of the past, how God used them in mighty ways, and it's almost discouraging. Like, I got nothing like that. You know, God never used me in that way, and I can't imagine him ever wanting to. What do you do? What do you do when you got nothing to give? Well, this guy had nothing to give, and this picture was prayer, obviously. This was a whole lesson on prayer. What do you do when you feel like you got nothing to give? And when you look around and the need is so great, and it seems like that we're so inadequate... You pray, okay? I mean, pray. Do we really pray? You say, I got nothing. Well, the Bible says you have not because you ask not. Got nothing to give. You been asking? Do we really pray? Do we even really know what it means when the Bible talks about fervent prayer? Do we know what that means? Fervent prayer. I'm not talking about, oh, God, I can't pay this bill. Oh, God, it's due today. Oh, you know, all of a sudden we get all fervent with our prayers when it's stuff for us and when we've got ourselves in trouble. But when we're seeing somebody else going through a hard time or something, fervent prayer. I wrote this down. Isn't the need great enough for us to really know how to get a hold of God? What if Jesus really was coming back soon? Okay. What if this thing really is winding down really quickly? All right. What if we are coming to the end of things rapidly? You think maybe we need to get a hold of God for the people that are not going with us? Those people that say, is it worth it? How can you believe this? What do you say to them? You know, you think, oh, if I knew more how to convince them. No, it's because maybe we're not We don't have the Spirit of God, or we're not as filled, we're not as godly as we think we are, we're not as Spirit-filled as we like to think we are, that sometimes we have those answers. I'm talking to myself. You know, the need is so great. We really, really, really need to know how to get a hold of God. Or do we maybe live in such a bubble that we don't even see what folks are going through? We don't see that woman down the street. We don't, or even our neighbors that are, you know, married to an alcoholic or whatever, going through an abusive type of relationship, or has nobody. Or maybe even thinking about entertaining thoughts of committing suicide. Just so miserable. Are we living in such a bubble that we don't even recognize those things? Or maybe that kid that's going to a public school. My granddaughter in Bath says that there are more kids in her class, more kids than not, that are, not say struggling, but are considering the whole sexual orientation thing. She said, sometimes I'm made to feel like I'm not cool or with it if I'm not willing to at least consider it. Or they're being taught evolution and taught a philosophy where it's just this life and then you die. And it's like, what's the use? What's there to live for? Do we live in such a bubble that we don't? What do we have? Do we have anything to give to those people? Maybe that man down the street that feels he's trying like crazy to make ends meet, and he just can't seem to get ahead, and he feels so inadequate, and he just doesn't feel like a man most of the time. Or maybe he's struggling with some kind of an addiction, drugs or alcohol or pornography or whatever, and just really has no place to turn. There's a need. Man, oh man. I don't know if we realize just how much people need us to have something to give. You say, I got nothing. Okay, you pray. But also, secondly, you ask for help. I know the parable here, the picture is that somebody going and asking for help of God. But he's also saying, you know, you got a friend, you're going to go ask for some help. Okay, now I have a couple of ways I want to look at that. One of them being this. Okay, bear with me. We can't do this by ourselves. Okay, we need each other. This small group thing is kind of a thing where we need each other. I got to tell you, man, I miss it. I like doing the live thing, sort of. It's weird talking to myself, looking in the screen, seeing myself there in the screen and talking. I understand that there's some use to it, but I love when I'm sitting in a table with people and discussing things, because I'm getting stuff from them. Not only feedback, but also it's just strange how God uses that. I remember when we first started it, I almost felt like I was compromising. Because this is the way, bless God, this is the way I'd always been taught in school, you know, this is the way it's supposed to be done. You're supposed to have Sunday school, supposed to be preaching service, supposed to be Sunday night preaching service, supposed to be Wednesday night preaching service. You know, bless God, that's the way it's done. Five to thrive, that's what they told us. Doesn't add up to five, but that's what they told us. Wait, no, that's vegetables. Whatever it was. But so when we started talking about doing the small group thing, I felt like I'm compromising until I started doing it, man. I'm loving it. Because it's like, man, we need each other. And it was kind of like this. I thought about Moses. You know, Moses was trying to serve over 2 million people in the wilderness. And his father-in-law saw him and he goes, what are you doing, man? You can't do this by yourself. You need some help. So they got some other guys to help. Okay. Now think about that interactively, how that works with a small group. Okay. Kind of in this way. It's awesome. The Bible says, confess your faults one to another. You ever be talking to somebody or have somebody come to you with a problem? They said, hey, Peggy, pray for me. I'm really struggling in this area, or I'm having a problem with this, or maybe, you know, things at home, and you start hearing them, listening to them about what's going on, and you're thinking, I'm kind of struggling with the same thing. You know, I've had, man, you have no idea how many times. My wife, I'm only saying this because it was awesome, because I do this every time. She was talking to somebody was meeting with my wife one time, and she come home and she said, I was trying to give them advice, or she was teaching some ladies about, you know, family stuff. And she goes, I realized, man, It's like the Lord was showing me stuff. I was telling him, and I was like, Lord's saying, you need to do this too. I said, man, that happens to me every time. I'll be in there sitting with a couple, and I'll start to say something, give them advice, counseling, and it's like, Lord going, you might want to start doing that too. It's like, ouch. You know, and sometimes just those conversations where people come to you, we need each other, people. We need each other. We cannot do this by ourselves. Keep going. So, what did I say? Pray and also get some help. And number three, share what you do have. You say, I got nothing to give. Share what you do have. I think of Elisha and the woman, the widow woman. I love this story where Elisha came to the widow woman during a famine and he says, hey, excuse me, ma'am, you got anything to eat? And she goes, well, as a matter of fact, we've got one more meal. My son and I are going to eat it and then we're going to die. We're just going to starve. We only got enough for one. Okay, I want you to try to think about this. All right, try to imagine this, okay? I go to Peggy's house. Okay, and Jeremiah's there. Everybody else is, you guys have all starved and died. Okay, so it's only Jeremiah and Peggy. And I go there and I said, hey, Peggy, here's the preacher man, right? I show up there and I go, hey, Peggy, you got anything to eat? And Peggy says, well, we got just enough for Jeremiah and me to eat one more meal, then we're going to die too. I'm like, oh, man, that's too bad. Can you make me something first? Jeremiah goes, I told you, Grandma, I hate that man. And she did, right? And God took care of her. God supplied the need. Matter of fact, he multiplied it. Like, wow. The story of the five loaves and the two small fishes, you know, it says, well, there's like 5,000 people here. Jesus said, make them sit down so we can feed them. These guys got to eat something. And they're like, what are we going to feed them? We ain't got no food. And they started looking around. One of the dudes goes, we got this kid here. He's got five loaves, which were basically like biscuits probably, five loaves and two small fishes. But they said, what is that among so many? It don't really matter if they were full-size Wonder Bread loaves. We got 5,000 people to feed here. And it doesn't really matter if they were big fish. We got 5,000 people to feed here. And he goes, okay, bring that to me. The kid shared what he had, and God multiplied it. This is the passage that came to my mind earlier this week. Peter walking into the temple, okay? He's going to the temple with John, and they're going to pray. And there's a guy there that was laid there every day. The Bible says that he was crippled from his mother's womb. He'd never walked his whole life. And they put him there to beg because, well, it's like Christian people, you know, religious people going through there and they'll give you something. And so that's how he made his living. And probably Peter, I'm sure Peter had seen him before, you know, other times. But this particular day, they're walking in there and the Bible says that he stopped. And he says, and Peter looked at him. Peter fastened his eyes on him. Didn't literally fasten his eyes, you know, like staple them to his head. No, that's stupid. Why would I even say something so stupid? He just stood there staring at him. I wonder if the dude saw him staring and just kind of like, what are you looking at? He's staring at me, kind of awkward. But then he said, hey, look at me. So I looked at him and he said, silver and gold have I none. Okay, what he said was, hey, look at me, man. He looked at him, he goes, I ain't got no money. Okay, so why do you want me to look at you? He goes, but what I do have, he said, I'll give you. He said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, he said, rise up and walk. I'm pretty sure that that was a cooler gift than money, okay? The money would have been cool, but this is way, way, way better, something eternal. Do we have anything like that to give? Do we have anything like that to give? Let me read you what I wrote down. Do we have anything of eternal value to give people? If not, why not? You notice, I think this might be one of the things when it comes to our prayer life and everything. In verse 5, I want you to notice one word in verse 5 that kind of stands out to me. When he says, he said unto him, which of you shall have a friend and shall go to him at midnight and say unto him, and I used to make fun of this word, but I don't anymore. Friend, lend me 3 loaves. Like the guy's going to go, what? You want to borrow them and bring them back? No, that's not what he meant. He said, these aren't for me. This is for somebody else. Do we ever pray? What would our prayers look like if we were actually were praying for other people? Lord, these guys need this. Lord, give this to me so I can give this to them. You know what we pray for? Lord, give me, and maybe I'll share some of it. But this is basically, it's all about me. Ouch. Ouch. I wrote this down. We usually pray, give me, and maybe we'll share. But he was asking for them. Maybe we'd have more to give if we didn't keep so much to ourselves. I heard a story. This preacher, I don't remember the preacher's name, years and years ago. Matter of fact, when I heard the name, I didn't recognize the name. But I'm talking years ago when people used to travel by train, right? This dude shows up at this town he was going to preach at, and he was traveled by train, and it was a cold night, got there late. It was about 11 o'clock at night, and he gets off the train, and there was this boy there that was selling papers. And he went over and he bought a newspaper from him. He didn't really pay any attention. You know, he's thinking about where he's got to go, and he sees a newspaper. Well, I could use a newspaper, see what's going on in this town or whatever. And so he buys this newspaper, and he gets a look at the kid, and the kid was kind of in rags, just maybe 11, 12 years old. And he said, hey, young fella, he said, you live around here? He says, yeah, I just live down here on the other side of the tracks. And he goes, you're out kind of late, aren't you? He said, aren't you afraid you're going to get in trouble for being out this late? He goes, no, no, no. He said, the police are my friends. He goes, they know why I'm here. He said, my dad died a few years ago, and he said, my mom has not been well. And he said, I'm kind of the man of the house. And he said, I've been selling papers. He said, I do this to help bring in some money and put a little food on the table and stuff. And he said, I go to school during the day. And the guy's like, oh, man. It was already like 11 o'clock at night. And he goes, how are you planning on being out? I'll sell a few more papers. He goes, you want to sell all of them? He goes, that'd be great. He said, if anybody wants to buy them, he said, I'd like to sell all these papers. He goes, here. He gave him $20. He goes, I don't got change for $20. He goes, I don't want change. Just give me the papers. Really? He goes, yeah, man. He goes, hey, come here. And he hugged the kid, and he kind of whispered a little prayer. And he looked at the boy, and he took his face in his hands. He said, aren't you cold? And he said, I was until you came. We got anything to give people? Is there anything worth any more than that, than to actually make a difference in somebody's life? I'm not talking about just buying somebody's papers. I think you get the idea. I got nothing to give. Number two, this one, again, these are just kind of random. I know they feel a little disjointed. They didn't when I put them on paper. But what keeps us from giving what we have? Maybe it's because we're, I don't know, a little selfish, or maybe so wrapped up in the things of the world. And I put this down, number two, got nothing to give. But we really got, when it comes to this world, we got nothing to gain. There's nothing to gain in this world. Now, two thoughts about this. First one is this. When it comes to how overwhelming things can be sometimes, about you feel like you're just giving, you got nothing else to give. And sometimes you feel like you're not making any difference, and you almost think about throwing in the towel. And I think about those disciples in John chapter 6, where there was actually a whole bunch of disciples, people that were called disciples. It was like 70-some, and then most of them left. Most of them, left. And Jesus turned to his disciples, the 12, and he said, will you also go away? And Peter goes, where are we going to go? Where are you going to go? Where are you going to go? But here's the other side of that. Because the world's really got nothing. But here's two passages. Jesus in Luke chapter 12 said this, a ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. He said, I know. I'll pull down my barns and build bigger ones. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, Thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said, Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then who shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. This idea of just being selfish and just taking in stuff for ourselves and not really about what's going on around us. Okay, but this one, this passage here, kind of goes along with that, but this is convicting to me. Mark chapter 8, and I'm sure you're familiar with this. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Now you think, I'll be honest with you. I read that passage right there. I read those two verses. I think I'm cool. You know, I'm saved. You know, I know better. Hey, I'm already a Christian. You know, I'm not giving anything in exchange for my soul. I've given my soul to the Lord. Ha ha, I'm cool. Until I thought of it in this light. How about this? What would I give in exchange for someone else's soul? You see, I got nothing to give. I got nothing. Well, what are we doing to get something? Like that man, even if we go back to the idea of prayer, you know, and what it costs. That dude that just wouldn't leave his friend alone until he gave him something to help somebody else. Oh, what will I give in exchange? I don't have time for this. I don't want them to think that I'm... Ouch. Lastly, I love this because of what Becky said. Okay. And again, I'm going to look at this from two different perspectives too. Okay. I got nothing to lose. There's some things that are very, very, very hard to describe to people. When somebody says to you, how do you know? How do you know that this is true? I think that song, He Lives, Christ Jesus Lives Today, you know that song, He Lives. If I'm not mistaken, this is only in my mind right now, I didn't look it up. I think it was written by a preacher. And I think it was written, like basically the seed thought of it happened on a Sunday morning. He was listening to the radio and there was some atheist on there and talking about God and putting it down and the whole resurrection thing and how it never happened. And this, how do you describe that? And this song came out of that. He says, it ends with, you ask me how I know he lives within my heart. There's just really no way to put it into word, right? But I'd love to try to imagine. Okay. Again, two thoughts. One for the Christian, one for the unsaved. If anybody's here unsaved. But I love this thought. And we already talked about this woman, this widow woman. All right. Imagine what it was like to be her. Here it is. This preacher comes to her house. She is already like, we're going to die. We are going to die. We're back to Peggy's house. We're going to die. This is not a good illustration because we know Peggy. Peggy is so godly. You know, I'm not kidding. And Peggy, but so, I mean, I'm trying to imagine somebody that's not as supernatural as Peggy. But what were they thinking? I'll be honest. Honestly, I imagine what it would be like to have somebody come. Somebody that you really didn't even know. Maybe you'd heard about this dude, that he was a preacher. And it was like, who do you... I know that at least for one thought she probably had, this woman probably had, was like, what? Who do you think you are? Did you just hear what I said? And then maybe she thought about it for a second. Well, he is a man of God. Maybe. What have I got to lose? I'm going to take a chance on God. What is it, that thing, when it comes to what we're talking about here, those opportunities that God lays out before you, or when we start, you know, again, looking around, starting to look outside of our bubbles and seeing folks that are in need and that little urging to step out. What do you got to lose? What do you got to lose? Given of yourself in ways, maybe if we started sharing what we do have, God would give us more to share. Okay? Maybe we got more to give than we know. There's that one. Second one is this. This is the one I thought when Becky was talking about this girl. That beggar, that cripple fella at the front of the temple there. Peter, here's Peter. The dude sits there. That was his life. I mean, that was what he'd done his whole life, basically, just how he made his living his whole life. Couldn't do anything. And then all of a sudden, here comes Peter and John, and they're walking by, and Peter stops and looks at him, and maybe the guy is sitting there going, you just know somebody's staring at you. And Peter goes, look at me. Okay. And he's like, oh, okay. He goes, I don't have any money. Okay. Oh, okay. He says, but what I do have, I'll give you. He said, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, he said, rise up and walk. What were that guy's thinking? What do you think he was thinking? What in the world, what would that be like? You know, he's sitting there going, what is this, a joke? You think this is funny? I'd be sitting there going, what? Oh, I get it. Yeah, you're probably going to try to get me to stand up and then let me fall down so that everybody will laugh at me. And Peter's standing there smiling, got his hand out. Says he took him by the hand, smiling. And he's like, I can't be this easy. But then that still small voice going, do it. Do it. Trust him. And he's thinking, what do I got to lose? What do I got to lose? Remember the day when somebody presented the gospel to you and it was like, that's too easy? And the still small voice going, you need this. What do you got to lose? Sure ain't got nothing to live for right now. Man, that's awesome. Put my glasses back on so I can see my notes because I'm almost done. I told you about I had something to say about my little experience about how this message came about, okay? Oh boy, I need this chair. Oh man, this is gonna hurt me. Not physically. There's no way I can do this justice. Okay, Friday. All right, this is the way my week normally goes. I love it, like, say, for instance, every once in a great while, come Friday evening, or sometimes it's been, there's been some Sundays where I haven't even left here after a Sunday morning service, and I'll already have a seed thought for what I'm going to preach the next week, you know, my messages. And then sometimes it'll go till maybe Wednesday, where it'll be like, I go to my Bible, I tell people, I said, I want to read my Bible, and I don't want to look for sermons. But that gets a little more difficult come Thursday. Come Thursday, I'm starting to think, man, Lord, I need something. And then I start looking in my Bible for stuff, you know, and I try not to, but it just kind of, this week, Friday. Oh, now wait, Friday, I get a call from Fred. He goes, hey, can you come down to the church? They're delivering sheetrock Friday morning. First thing in the morning, okay. I come down here. I'm down here for 2 hours. I didn't sleep well. I'm down here dozing, all right? I said, you guys need help? In the back of my mind praying, please don't need no help. Please. I don't want to carry sheetrock. They're like, no. Okay. So I came in here for a couple hours. It's like, Lord, I should have had my Bible. Didn't bring my Bible. I come down here, was puttering around. And then I went home. Okay, I'm going to do some studying right now. Then I get another call. Somebody was bringing us something else. I'd come back down here for that. Then I get another call. Fred goes, hey, can you help them? They're going to be bringing insulation in. You got to help them unload insulation. Okay. Go home. Now it's Friday evening. And I stopped. And it was like, Lord, I got nothing. And it was like the Lord said, really? You got nothing? Whose fault's that? And really, you've got nothing. And I started thinking about the stuff I got, the opportunities that I have, or the opportunities I have to have something to give people. Because I'm like, and I'd even glorify my prayers by making saying, Lord, this is not for me, this is for them. Lord, I got to have something for them. I got nothing. What are you going to do about it? Okay, here's a story. This might not fit for you, but it fit for me. Because, be honest with you, sometimes you start feeling a little overwhelmed and like you got nothing. It's like, Lord, it's almost like it's the Lord's fault and like he's not giving you anything. I heard a preacher telling this story. He was doing a meeting, preaching a meeting somewheres, and you got to know this down south, and so these guys, you know, they have these services, and then especially these, you know, singers and stuff, and people get pretty wound up during the music. And I'll be honest with you, I was having a little time this morning. My wife doesn't know how close she came to being horrified out of bed, just scared to death, because I heard a song this morning. I was listening to it on my headphones. What's the name of the group? Nobody cares, but now that it's stuck in my head, I won't be able to. Assurance. Brian Free and Assurance. They sing a song that says, "I'm redeemed." Oh, man. Just really quiet. Just going. Just all excited about it, you know. And just sometimes down south, man, people be singing and they'll just be shouting. He said, this particular service, he said, this for this night, he said, it was kind of subdued. He said, but there was a family up there singing, "God's Been Good." And he said, there was about five people in the service in wheelchairs. He said, there was one dude named Wayne. He said, about 26 years old. He said, I don't know what was the matter with him, but he's paralyzed and he's crippled up pretty bad. And his speech was very slurred. It was hard to understand him. But he said he was just really agitated. And during the singing, and he said his hands were kind of gnarled up, and he was such bad shape that they had to have him strapped in with a seatbelt into his wheelchair. And he's sitting there, and he's just kind of agitated. And he said he was like tears, and he's like, "Is he okay? Is he getting into this or what?" And he said after a while, he said he kind of worked his seatbelt loose. He said, "The seatbelt come off." He said, "Now I'm sitting there on the platform. You know, this family's singing," and he said, "I'm kind of watching him," and he says, and he kind of got his legs under him, and he said, and he just got himself scooted on the edge of the wheelchair, and he said, pretty soon he just kind of went, and he just fell down, right on his face, fell on the ground, and he goes, I kind of got up and looked around, and he said, and the guy started crawling. He said, he was in the front row, but he started crawling towards the altar, and he said, at first I thought, is he looking, trying to get up, or what's he doing? And he said, I got down there, and I got to thinking, is he crawling to the altar? And he said, I'm thinking, if he's crawling to the altar, he said, I want to know what he's going to say. He said, so I got down there with him, both, he said, have to find, make sure if he, you know, see if he needed any help, but to see what he was going to say. He said, he got up there, he said, he crawled up to the altar, and he was crying, and he said, God, you've been so good to me. Okay, I saw this yesterday, and I thought, you got nothing? You got everything. The verse, the Bible says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Got everything. And I keep it to myself. I'm not willing to share. Everything I need is available. It's up to us. If we got nothing, it's up to us to lay hold of it for somebody else. Father God, thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you, God, for your patience with us. Lord, your patience with me. Thank you. Lord, I don't know if anybody else needed this, but Lord, I needed this. God, help me, Lord, not to take any of this for granted or to not act upon this. God, the need is great. Lord, the truth is, Lord, I feel sometimes, I absolutely feel like that this church could do way better than me. That is a given. But Lord, the truth is you got me here right now, and you got each one of us here, Lord, for a reason. And that reason is for more than just taking up space and just filling up a spot in a pew. God, you got us here for somebody else. whether that person's even in this building yet or not. God, help us to be ready for what's next for that individual. Lord, those people are all around us that need us. God, Becky talking about opportunities. Lord, we are we're surrounded by opportunities. Every individual is an opportunity waiting to happen. God, help us, help us, help us. With our heads bowed, a couple questions. I don't even know how to do this other than say, you know what, pray for me. Pray for me. Maybe the Lord put something specific on your heart and mind. Maybe not. Maybe it's just that, Lord, I need prayer. I need prayer. If you want to put your hand up, put it right back down. Yes, yes, yes. Pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me. Yes. One more question. If you were to die today, do you know for sure that you go to heaven? I'm not doing this to embarrass anybody, okay? And every one of us that's saved had to come to this place at one time or other. But, you know, maybe there's some doubts. I don't know. But here's the question. If you died today, do you know for sure that you go to heaven? If you don't know, I'm not going to have you stand. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to do anything to embarrass you. But this is just between you, me, and God. I'm wondering if you'd be willing to just put your hand up, put it right back down, and say, pray for me. I don't know. I don't know. Pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me that I'll get this thing settled before it's too late. Pray for me. Father, again, Lord, thank you for your goodness. Lord, my hand is right up with the rest of them. Lord, I pray, God, that you'll help me, God, not to be so self-centered in my life. And God, help me to take this more seriously, not to hide from it or run from it or ignore it. God, again, thank you for your love and your mercy toward us. God, I pray, God, again, like the disciples said, Lord, that you'll, even this week, Lord, that you'll teach us to pray. Lord, thank you for these guys. I pray that you'll bless them. I pray that you'll give them a good remainder of the day. I pray that you'll give them a safe trip home. Lord, good week. But Lord, I pray now that you'll dismiss us with your blessings. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.